My name is David Varela. I'm a writer and a producer in many different media. My job title changes all the time in this business. Sometimes I'm a producer, sometimes I'm an experienced designer, sometimes a narrative designer. My business cards don't have a job title on anymore. But my main skill is as a writer. That's where I come from. So publishing and books are close to my heart. And I've been asked to talk about old IPs and intellectual properties like novels and how they can be given new life using new media. So I'm going to focus on some recent work I did with Sherlock Holmes, but I also want to add a few examples of easy and affordable ways to reinvent old material, even if you're not working with a globally recognized property like Sherlock. But first, I want to take you back in time. This is what my education looked like. Books, a lot of books. When I left university 20 years ago-ish, my job did not exist. What I do now was unimaginable back then. And it's certainly not something I could have taken a degree in at university. The media landscape has changed so much in those 20 years with social media, email, games as a real storytelling mechanism, smartphones, Netflix. The whole ecosystem of media has become much more fragmented. And every medium has its own strengths and weaknesses, and its own audiences and its own conventions. And the media world has changed, and so has the job of being a writer. And writers have had to adapt to survive, and so have the media properties. The intellectual properties have changed shape as the media landscape has changed shape to fit those new formats and the expectations of these new audiences. But of course, our generation, our modern world, we're not the first generation to deal with multiple media, especially if you look at the example of Sherlock Holmes. When Sir Arthur Conan Doyle created Sherlock Holmes, it was in a novel. He wrote a novel, A Study in Scarlet, which is here, published in 1887. And then there was a second novel in 1890. But it wasn't until he started writing the Sherlock Holmes character in short stories for Strand magazine in 1891 that the popularity of the character and those stories really accelerated. So in the world before cinema, this was probably the equivalent of making a feature film and then getting a TV series. So Conan Doyle only wrote 4 Sherlock Holmes novels, but he wrote 56 short stories. These murder mysteries with the great detective found their natural form, I think, in the shorter story, in the magazines, not in the novel where it was born. So Conan Doyle himself was the first person to start adapting Sherlock to a new medium, and it worked incredibly well. Because I think Conan Doyle didn't just create a great character in Sherlock Holmes, he also pioneered a new genre, that sort of short-form detective fiction. That's why his stories are so enduring, and why every other fictional detective is walking in the footsteps of Sherlock Holmes. These stories were the precursors of pulp fiction in the United States with those detective stories in magazines, and you can trace a line from here through that pulp fiction through to the TV detective police procedural series which dominates the TV schedules around the world today. Everybody loves a good murder, especially if it can be committed and solved before dinner time. According to a piece of research that was conducted in 1995, so that's when I was at university, so these figures are 20 years old, there have been over 25,000 adaptations of Sherlock Holmes stories into other media, films, TV series, plays, radio, and more recently, video games. And I would like to talk about one of those 25,000 adaptations that I was involved in. Sherlock the Network was created to accompany the BBC TV adaptation of the Sherlock Holmes stories, which star Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman. I worked as a writer and narrative designer on this project. I use the title narrative designer here because it's a very useful way of describing the job. It's not just about writing the dialogue and the text. It's about choosing which media are used for which part of the story and getting involved in things like game design, puzzle design, casting, all those other factors that influence how the story is told. Anyway, it's kind of an interactive episode of the TV show, which we released as an app on Android and iOS. So it's a game based on a TV series, based on a character from a novel who is adapted into magazines. The app tells a self-contained story and includes original scenes with the main cast from the TV show. And the whole thing was supervised by the producers of the TV show as well. They wanted this to be exactly as good as any broadcast episode of the TV show. And it was a co-production between Hartswood Films, who are the private production company who make Sherlock, and a digital developer called The Project Factory. The BBC, who are normally associated with Sherlock, were not involved in this project at all. The BBC is a very large bureaucratic organization, and things tend to move faster without them. I'm going to show you a short video, I hope, to give you an idea of how the game all works. Also, another apology. Everybody here speaks in English. They speak very fast. I apologize. Let's see if this video works.
So, you want to be in the homeless network.
Clearly you look the part, and yep. I'm going to give you a fact, that's how we stay in touch.
I need the whole network to keep their eyes and ears open.
So you're helping out Sherlock now, yes?
Get over to Scotland Yard, see if you can be of assistance.
Take a look around, carefully.
Our kidnapper's been in touch again with this.
What you're asking for is very sensitive technology. Do not disappoint me.
That's it then. Case solved.
Even you're bright enough to figure out the rest. Very personal.
Innocent people will die.
Get me through! I'm a doctor!
And their blood will be on your hands.
Chop, chop.
That was
a
close one. That was all very dramatic. So easy. See my skull?
Okay, so just to give you some background, the show was created by Stephen Moffat and Mark Gatiss, who are probably two of the best writers in TV at the moment. They created the show, they also write most of the episodes. And they have a real love and appreciation of the original Sir Arthur Conan Doyle stories. In fact, every episode of the show on TV has been a modernized version of one of those original stories. And the trouble is, they want to protect that material to use for future episodes of a TV show. So when I was asked to create this game, I had to come up with an entirely different story, a new original Sherlock Holmes story that sounded like it was written by Conan Doyle and updated by Stephen Moffat and Mark Gatiss. So that was a challenge, especially when the company themselves were very secretive about the TV show that they were making. I started work on this when they were in the middle of filming season 3. I met Stephen Moffat in a caravan in a field in the middle of nowhere when they were filming the last episode of season 3. And they were so secretive about the story that I had to just ask questions where they could answer yes or no to find out what the story of season 3 would be so that I could create a story that would be similar but not not conflicting with what they were doing in their season on TV. So after a little bit of yes and no, I came up with a treatment, a short idea of the main story for the game, and they came back and said, actually, this is a little bit like the story we're doing in episode 2 of our season, so could you just come up with something different? So I went away, came up with a completely new story again, and they said, yeah, that's episode 3, don't do that. And eventually they just said, okay, we're going to give you the scripts. Nobody else in the world is allowed to see these scripts. If anybody sees these scripts, we'll know that they've come from you. But at least it showed that I'd earned their trust, and I was definitely on the same wavelength as them, problematically on the same wavelength. And I'd earned their trust. And after that, it became much easier. We agreed on a storyline for the main plot, and then got into the 10 individual cases which would make up the story of the game. There are 10 cases in total, but about half of those, are part of one larger adventure, the kidnapping of Mrs. Hudson, their housekeeper. But there were some that were little stories in their own right. Then when we finally got to film with the cast, we were on set on the last day of filming of the whole season. So the crew was already very stressed because they had a lot to get through. And we became this little, like a short film crew on set in this big film, in the middle of this big film production. So yeah, that was me. I was doing boom duty and holding reflectors and just working like a little indie filmmaker. We could only get one actor at a time because the whole show, basically either Sherlock or John Watson are on screen in almost every scene. So we had to write the story in a way that you would only ever have one of them on screen at a time. We couldn't have any scenes with both of them because we would never be able to get both of the actors at the same time. And we had to film the scenes in order of priority. We knew that we would not have enough time to get everything that we needed, so we just shot the most important scenes first. We shot the introductory scene, then we shot the final scene, then we shot anything that we could fit in between. We got about 70% of what we wanted, and anything that we didn't get on video, we picked up in an audio recording session after production. So rather than it being, say, a FaceTime message on video, we said, okay, this is going to be a voicemail message in audio only. So we got all the material, and then we stitched it together into an app, which, together with games and clues and photographs, created a single linear story. But I don't want to talk too much about the technical aspects of the project. Instead, I want to talk about the principles behind it, because those, I think, are principles that anybody can apply, you can apply, to updating your own IP into a new medium. So the key to creating a successful adaptation or an extension of your story into a new medium is authenticity. If your product doesn't feel authentic compared to the original, the audience will see straight through it and you failed. If you want to feel immersive and retain that sense of authenticity, there are 5 basic things you have to get right. The characters. In our case, they needed to be exactly the same versions of Sherlock and John Watson and Mycroft Holmes as in the TV show. So we got Benedict Cumberbatch and Martin Freeman and Mark Gatiss, and the audience were surprised that we got the real Sherlock. It made it much more powerful for them and made it much more successful, I think. Location, we filmed on the same sets as the TV show, and the story had a very strong sense of London, which is an important part of the stories. The tone of voice we had to get right as well. The language, the sense of humor, the intelligence of the stories are arguably what makes them successful. And theme, this is, it's kind of like tone of events as opposed to tone of voice. The things that happen in the story had to feel like they would be in a Sherlock Holmes story. So there's a murder, it's complicated, nobody else could possibly solve this case. It had to feel like a Sherlock Holmes story. And the rules is, it's a bit of a catch-all title for the natural laws of the story. If it was a science fiction story, you can have space travel. In Harry Potter, you can have magic. In a Sherlock story, you don't get that, but you do get super intelligent people and cryptic messages, that kind of thing. So those are the absolute basics you need to get right with any kind of adaptation or update of your story. If you start adding interactivity, though, that opens up a whole new set of questions. First of all, what is your role as a player? Who are you? Would you be playing as Sherlock or as John Watson or in a different story? Do you, are you Batman? Are you Robin? It's a question we'll come back to in a minute. The framing device. In other words, why are you doing this as a player? Why are you doing this right now? And then there's the mechanics. What do you do? What are the verbs at your disposal? Are you shooting? Are you running? Are you crushing candy? What actions can you take in the game? So here's how we answered those questions in the case of Sherlock. It's an interactive story, so you need to have an active role. You can't be an observer. And in this case, we decided that you would become part of Sherlock's homeless network. This is our modern version of what Conan Doyle called the Baker Street Irregulars, which is his network of street kids and homeless people who act as Sherlock's informants around London. To get to this decision, we asked ourselves, what is the most fun you can have in Sherlock's world? And actually, being Sherlock is probably not very fun at all. Sherlock is miserable. He has a horrible life. He's bored all the time. No, it's much more fun to go on an adventure with Sherlock and John. So in this case, you play the game as yourself. You're not given a name. You choose your name for yourself. All the pronouns or the language in the game is gender neutral. You can import your Facebook photo as your icon. So you play as you. And that helps create a sense of connection to the characters. And I always feel that whenever you play as a sort of third person, as a named character like Lara Croft or Sherlock Holmes, it puts a barrier between you and the game. You're already acting a bit, and it slightly weakens that connection, that immersion. So in this case, Sherlock is talking to you. And that is quite an emotionally powerful thing. Just after we launched the game, within about 2 hours, we got our first complaint on Twitter. The main problem of becoming part of the network is that I'm constantly blushing. We made people blush because, unlike on TV, our videos were shot in first person, as you saw in that video there. The characters talk to you down the lens of the camera. And it has an emotional impact. There were other messages as well. The introduction video to the Sherlock, oh my God, I can't breathe. I was just insulted and sniffed by Sherlock, rude. I'm strangely okay with it, however. And I think the fact that we encourage people to play wearing headphones as well on a portable device that they hold close to them, so it's a solo experience. It feels much more intimate than TV, watching a TV screen from across the room. Even when you were watching on this huge, beautiful screen, the trailer video, it's a lot less immersive than if you're sitting with headphones watching it closely so that Sherlock is whispering in your ear and sniffing you closely. The device you're using makes a big difference to the emotional impact of the story. And one of the things I want to really emphasize is the importance of playing to the strengths of the medium that you're communicating in. And on the subject of the device, the framing device is the phone itself. At the start, the very start of the game, the first video you see, Sherlock says he's going to give you a phone. And that makes you feel like you're holding a piece of Sherlock's world. This is the phone that Sherlock gave you. So the framing device is literally the device in your hand. So when you get voicemails and FaceTime messages and texts, they all feel like they're coming to your phone. We had Martin Freeman here filming himself on the producer's iPhone so that when we put those videos into the game, it really felt like it was a FaceTime message. We gave him a script, he'd run off around the corner, film himself, come back, show us what he shot. So we told the story in the way that felt most suitable to the medium. This wasn't just a TV episode that you watch on a phone. This was a story that was told in the natural language of a smartphone. Voicemail messages, text messages, FaceTime, images. And to maintain that sense of being in Sherlock's world, we make sure that the mechanics matched what you might expect in a Sherlock story. So you spend a lot of time talking to witnesses, racing across London as fast as you can, analyzing crime scenes, cracking codes, decrypting sound files and images, and then piecing together the evidence in your mind palace over there. What you don't do is kill anyone, race cars, match three objects in a line. Those kind of mechanics are fine in other games, but they would not feel authentic in the Sherlock world. I'm going to spend one moment talking about money, because it's important. When we launched the game in the App Store, it was as a premium app. We charged £2.99, which is, I think, was €3.99, which is quite expensive for an app. But it's the same price as a TV episode was selling in the on iTunes. So pricing strategy is very important. Fans of a TV show were very happy to pay for new content, and they largely gave five-star reviews to it as well. For almost 2 weeks, it was the most downloaded premium app in the UK, and notice also that we put it in the entertainment category. This was not in the games category, it was in entertainment. And that is very important because it set expectations of what the content was going to be. Gamers would have been maybe a little bit disappointed that there was too much video and too much story in here. So we set the expectation that this is a piece of entertainment, like a TV show. But it also meant that the entertainment chart is a lot less competitive than the games chart on the App Store. Because it is less competitive, that means that this was number one in the entertainment chart for much longer. That made it more visible, which led to more sales, which kept it at number one for longer. It has this snowball effect. So if you're creating an app, I would say, definitely think about which category you would put it in. And then we learned another really important lesson. After that initial wave of fans paid money for the game, we decided to move it to a freemium model. So you could download the app for free, play the first two cases for free, and then if you wanted to play the other eight cases, you had to pay £2.29, I think, a little bit less. And as soon as we started looking at the reviews on the App Store, we learned a really important psychological pricing lesson. As soon as the game went freemium, we got a huge wave of reviews at one star. Lots of people complaining because they were shocked that they would be asked to pay any money at all for this. The app was exactly the same, the content was exactly the same, and they weren't complaining about the quality of the app. They were protesting against the fact that it wasn't free. And that severely damaged the star rating of the game, which in turn damaged sales, and it has the kind of opposite snowball effect. So it's frustrating, but I'm not sure that going freemium to try and get some more sales was worth the damage to the reputation of the IP. A five-star rating has a value of its own. and it reflects on the quality of the IP in other media. So I would just warn you against going down that road and potentially damaging the reputation of your property. I can talk about Sherlock all day, but I'm aware that time is ticking away, and I have a few other projects that you might find useful. I did a similar presentation to this a few months ago, and a publishing executive came up to me and asked, "How do you persuade people? How do you persuade a million people to buy your game?" And my answer, which didn't make him very happy, is you start with 100 million fans, and then it's easy. And he wasn't very happy because not every publisher is lucky enough to have something like Sherlock Holmes as a property to work with. Most publishers and most authors have a smaller audience, smaller fan base, smaller budget, and that means making an app with Benedict Cumberbatch is probably not cost effective. But the good news is that there are plenty of other ways to breathe new life into your properties, and they can be very affordable. So in the few minutes I have left, I want to talk about three new projects which I worked on, taking three very different approaches to telling stories, all using very cheap or free tools, reaching new audiences in new ways. And of those three approaches, choosing which suits you will depend on what you think is the heart of your intellectual property. Maybe there is a brilliant main character who you want to foreground. Maybe there's a real-world location that gives great sense of identity to your property. Or maybe you have an author who is, you know, a great personality in themselves and is very marketable, not just for their writing. So here are a few ideas of what you can do. This is a project I worked on called Some Change. It was commissioned as part of a book festival, the Folkestone Book Festival, and the local authorities in this town in England called Folkestone are trying to regenerate the neighborhood by promoting the arts. And they asked me to tell some kind of story that wasn't a book, anything but a book. And I worked with a class of children at the Folkestone Academy, and they were studying two books for GCSEs for their exams. One was a graphic novel of Dracula, and the other was a novel about homelessness, living on the street. So we ended up creating a comic book style adventure about living on the street. And we put it on the pavements of the streets of Folkestone. If you've ever played a choose your own adventure book, you'll recognize this style of storytelling. So there were 45 big stickers like this, the size of posters, designed by Spieler Strückel, who's over here too, referring to the geography around you and asking you to make choices or flip a coin or throw a coin onto a grid on the ground to decide matters of chance. And you would follow whichever path you chose around town. There were multiple endings. I just wanted to show this because it shows that even in the digital age, you don't always need to be digital to be creative, to be interactive. All you needed for this game was some printing and a coin. And it turned the whole of the town into a kind of theatrical set for the story, with you in the middle of it. So it's a brilliant way of restaging an IP that has a strong sense of location. So these are all real landmarks when you look at these directions here. Walk along the streets, go towards that camping store, go to the old post office. It's a really good way of pointing out details of a place that perhaps the residents have never even noticed. And this story was put on the pavements in November, so when it refers to you being cold, you really do feel cold. The only costs really were my time, the time of a designer, and the printing costs. It was cheap. It was a very affordable way of telling a story. And every one of those big stickers was an advertisement for the project as a whole. And it attracted a lot of attention because it was so public. So that's one method. If your property has a very strong central character, you might want to try something like this, using social media to bring them to life. This was a project I worked on with a dance company called Nocturne. Nocturne wanted to reach beyond their usual typical dance audience, which is rich white people who go to the National Ballet, and they wanted to go to a new audience instead. So instead of performing in one of the same venues, they decided to do a production on Facebook. And rather than just film a 90-minute dance production and put that video on Facebook, which they could have done, they asked me to work with them to create a character called Miss White, who lived on Facebook. This was only actually a research project. It was a research and development project funded by the Arts Council of England, looking into how the arts can be communicated on Facebook. But it actually turned into a rather nice piece of work in itself. So our story followed Miss White, who is a terribly proper English lady whose dreams began to appear on Facebook as videos on her Facebook page in the middle of the night. And that's where the contemporary dance part came in. And while the dancing was performed by a dancer called Harriet Waghorn, the role of Miss White on Facebook in text was played by me. So I posted messages in character as her each day and responded to messages and comments for 3.5 weeks. And over that time, her polite personality cracked and she became a little bit more human, and we got to learn the cause of this fractured personality. So there were 9 videos. Each video was between 1 and 3 minutes long, and they were designed for easy online viewing anywhere. It was also, like I said, a research project looking into the power of advertising on Facebook. And we found that by spending a few $100s, I think it was maybe $400 or $500, on targeted advertising, we attracted almost 20,000 followers to her page. Otherwise, the platform itself is free. We spent some money recording the dance videos, but really we were just using what is freely available on Facebook as a performance platform, using all of its multimedia capability to tell a rich emotional story. So I think you might just be able to see the URL there still, facebook.com/MissJJWhite. You can see how it all played out chronologically on her page. It's a very simple, cheap way of telling a story if you want to highlight the character. The third option, maybe you have an enthusiastic author who doesn't mind being the public face of your product. So you could do something like this. I produced a project called the Live Writing Series, which was essentially live improvised writing in public by 7 writers in 7 public venues, including the National Portrait Gallery, which was why we have this picture. So the writers would sit in these spaces and take commissions from people in person and online, responding to what they were asked to write about. And every letter, every keystroke was broadcast live online and also projected on the wall of the gallery. So it was like having an open Google Doc where you could see the writing process happening as it was happening. In the National Portrait Gallery, on the night that I was working, there were 4,000 people and a band and a bar, and it was very intense, getting a lot of suggestions. It was a very responsive audience, and it's great to write something and then hear people laughing about it straight away. There are a lot of authors who would hate this kind of experience, so it's not for everybody, but it is a very clear, very public way of making writing feel alive and contemporary and getting people excited about it. So, those are 3 very quick, cheap ways of making perhaps an older property feel more lively. I think that's all I have time for. If you have any questions, I'm here all morning, or you can contact me on Twitter at Writing Studio or through davidvarela.com. Thank you for listening.